privilege this morning to stand up there in front of the greatest infantry battalion in the Marine Corps, 39th Third Marines. Pretty exciting day we got ahead of us too, as well, not only this morning but this evening down at Paradise Cove, and definitely looking forward to sharing this education and also camaraderie with you Marines and sailors today. Before I turn it over to our guest speaker this morning, I do want to introduce a few of the members of our audience down here in the front row. Starting over here to my left, Colonel Castagnetti. Sir, thank you very much for being here this morning. I should mention too as well, in retirement, he has for several years run the National Cemetery down at Punchbowl, so we thank you for your continued service in that capacity also. Next to him this morning is Mr. Dunn, a veteran Marine. And he currently is also serving as a docent down at the Aviation Museum on Ford Island, so we thank you for your service and continued service down there. And if you're ever down at the museum, please ask for Mr. Dunn, and you'll be able to see him there. Next to him is Mr. Livingston, a former chair of the Navy League. So we thank you for your service there, sir. And also next to him is Dr. Bonert, who will also be providing some of the PME this morning. And our final guest here this morning is Mr. McDermott, the Hawaii State, a member of the Hawaii State Representatives, and also a veteran Marine himself. Thank you very much, sir, for your service. Without further ado, I would like to turn it over to our honored guest this morning, our guest speaker for our professional military education, Mr. P.T. Brent, a veteran infantry Marine himself, having served for several years, also prominently known as a very successful American businessman and entrepreneur, having spanned several different industries, including the computer programming and cruise line industry, amongst several others. Very influential, huge advocate of the Marine Corps, most recently also well known as a journalist, having published over 150 articles and stories, and has been embedded with the Marines three times in Iraq, Afghanistan, as well as Djibouti, Africa, and also published numerous books. We cannot thank him enough for his service and his continued service to the Marine Corps for all that he does for all of us in uniform and that are out of uniform as well. Without further ado, please welcome our guest speaker this morning, Mr. P.T. Brent.
Marines? Marines? You're about to receive your first politically incorrect PME. You know, Colonel Castagnetti here kind of haunts me. He was running Punchbowl, the cemetery of the Pacific, and it was a couple days before I went to my third trip to Afghanistan, and I said, Colonel, if I come back in a body bag, are you going to have a place for me at the Punchbowl, the cemetery? He looked at me quite seriously, and he said, P.T., I will, but you got to be there next Monday morning. Okay, your first politically incorrect PME. How many have been to the National Museum of the Marine Corps? The founder of the National Museum of the Marine Corps, General Ron Christmas, said, Marines are never politically correct. Marines are never politically correct. We're just correct. Your heart's in the right place. General Amos started something for E-4s and E-5s. The NCOs are the heartbeat of the Marine Corps, heartbeat of any military. And he calls it the reawakening. Does anybody remember the reawakening? Because what helps us survive is we're more into our history and our traditions and educating each other than the other branches. I've interviewed people out of Navy boot camp, no history. They didn't know who John Paul Jones was. One thought he was an NFL quarterback. So what we're going to do here is we're going to have a time machine. Our time machine is going to take us in the past and the future. The first time machine takes us to a nightclub in Paris. And the first one, we're in the nightclub of Paris, and this is a song from 1880 written by Jacques Offenbach. Jacques Offenbach wrote this song in 1880 for a French gaiety theater. This is where the girls did the can-can. Oddly enough, the Catholic Church forbade the can-can, the tango, and the hula. So I don't know what Marines were doing in the theater that night, but anyway, Jacques Offenbach wrote this musical. It's called Genevieve Brabant. The first one of you that recognizes this song, I want you to raise your arm. Brady said to me, if you're going to do a PME, every PME has to have a good C story. Did I have that right, Colonel?
Correct, yes, sir.
And does anybody here know the definition of a good C story? Come on. Okay, well, I suspect that a couple of fellows here in the front row do, because they've told a few. Good C story never allows reality to get in the way of you and a really good story. So now we're going to go into another time machine in the future. We're going to go to the year 2077, way in the future. We're going to be in a little rural farm area in Pueblo, Colorado. And there's a really crippled up wreck. Guy who's seen one of the oldest, most decrepit human beings you ever saw on one of those green and yellow tractors, you know, the John Deere? John Deere. Green, you know, it's got this John Deere tractor, the tires is as big as twice the size of this wreck of a guy. And he's got a green for utilities, a green shirt, some boots, and he's driving this tractor and he's just a wreck. And on the tractor it's all faded and chipped because this guy's been doing it for a long time. And the chapter it's got Marine Corps emblem, it's got Sergeant Major stripes. And it's got the name, all fade away, Michael Martinet, USMC. Then it's got a little soccer player, and he's number 8 from Pueblo High School. You can hardly read it, because the tractor and he are both in bad shape. So he's plowing along, doing, I think, some soybeans, and all of a sudden, along a 40-acre parcel there, he hears a big bang, and out of the sky comes a bird. Bird falls down right between the fence line and the tractor. The old guy looks at it, all of a sudden, coming down the road, is a big, big guy, about 6'4", with some New York kind of dude with those shotgun shells and a fancy vest. He's got a big shotgun. He's walking down the road and he says, "Hey, old timer, that's my bird. I'm coming over to get it." And the old guy in the tractor says, No. Here in Colorado, it's birds on my property. It's my bird." And the guy said, "You know who I am? I'm Saul Leibowitz. I'm the meanest, toughest lawyer from New York City you ever saw. If I don't get that bird, I'll sue you one side of your body down the other." Well, the old Sergeant Major says, here in Colorado, especially here in Pueblo, we don't have much of that litigating stuff, but we do have a way of solving things. What's that?" He says, "We have the three-kick rule." Anybody remember the three-kick rule? How about you've done that, Bob? So the three-kick rule, so he says, "How does it go?" He says, "Well, I'll get off the tractor and I'll kick you 3 times. Then you kick me 3 times, back and forth. Whoever gives up, the other guy gets the bird." So the big dude from New York, about a 30-year-old stud, looks at it, thinks this pathetic wreck. He says, "Okay, I'll do that." So he comes over, puts down his gear and a shotgun, and the Nope. Sergeant Major Track gets him. All of a sudden, Sergeant Major's standing like straight and tall. He looks like he's 25 years old again. His adrenaline's flowing. He looks like he's just out of boot camp. And he walks right up to that nasty lawyer, and he takes his starboard boot, and he plants it right where the Mississippi and Missouri meet. Wham! And that New York guy crumples over halfway. Then Sergeant Major goes around and whacks him in the calf, and he goes down on the deck. Then just for his third kick, he goes over and whams him right in the ribs. The guy's breathing. He's taking a lot of time. 5 minutes breathing. Crawls over the fence. He slowly gets up. And he says, okay, my turn. Sergeant Major smiles, says, nah, you keep the bird. We're going to go to the National Museum of the Marine Corps for a couple minutes. This is a newsstand. Did sell newspapers in 1918, and this is an exhibit at the Marine Museum. Most people seem to miss this, but I'll let it rip.
Papers, 4 years of war leaves millions dead. Get your latest news here. Big news from France. Read all about it. Germans close to Paris, 25 miles in 5 days. Those Huns are tough. They're really putting the squeeze on those poor folks in France. The French are fleeing. Get the whole story right here, folks. French ask America for help. That's right. France knows they are no match for the Germans, so we send thousands of Marines. Says here, when the French said war's over, you better retreat. A Marine told them, retreat? Hell, we just got here. Those Marines, those Leathernecks, they're always the first to fight. That's right, folks. Hard news right here, straight from the battlefield. Hard news right here from the reporter on the scene. Get your papers here. Big news from France. Our Marines are headed to a big fight at Belleau Wood. Hey, folks, go see for yourself the big fight. Right over there.
Okay. Everybody hear me okay? Okay, I'm involved in the Marine Corps Museum, the Heritage Foundation, and we leased a farmer's field in Virginia with the same topography as Belleau Wood. Same with the wood line and the wheat field. And we took real Marines from the base of Quantico, and we reenacted a key battle in the fight for Belleau Woods. We also hired 4 actors, and on day 3, we fired them all, because they're just not Marines. Just like when they filmed Palmetto Jack. They were just actors. So we did this.
Get off! Okay. Got a couple of, Battle of Woods is one, General Hickey, a historian, says, three battles defined the Marine Corps. Obviously, Battle of Woods. Can anybody tell me the other two battles that defined the Marine Corps? Raise your arm. What? Two battles, other two battles. Three battles, according to the former Commandant, General Hickey, defined the Marine Corps. Anybody know the other two?
Guadalcanal.
No.
Chisholm Reservoir.
Right. Well, come here.
Good answer.
Okay, give that back to me. Hey. Stop it. You can't keep it. Get out of here. It was in the strike zone. What does he want?
Okay, I got a couple more.
What was the guy that just answered? What's your name? Okay. See me later.
The